your input. It's your voice, your future, and this is your chance to have some of your questions answered this evening. We will get to as many as we can, not only here in the theater, but also from the questions that we have solicited online. And now, with a little bit more about how you can continue to submit your questions, is Rich Pierce, anchor at WTOV Fox 9 in Wheeling. Rich.
Rick, thank you very much. And here's how to submit your questions. You can use the hashtag YourVoiceYourFuture on Twitter, or you can go to either station's Facebook page. You can go to WCHS, WVAH TV Facebook page, or fans of WTOV TV. I'm going to be monitoring those questions all night long, and we've also got some that were submitted via email earlier this week that we'll try to get to. But first, Governor Justice, we want to start with this question from Louise Rigby. Why did you promise no tax increases during your campaign, and now you want to raise taxes?
Well, let me just tell you this. First and foremost, I promise you that Jim Justice doesn't want to raise your taxes. That's the last thing in the world I really truly thought that we would have to do. But when you go and you're able to do what I was able to do and look under the sheets after you're elected and really get into the nitty-gritty, you find a situation that's beyond dire. And you better listen to me about this. You couldn't possibly know. You couldn't possibly have any idea what on the brink we are. And the simple fact is just this. We have done nothing to cure this problem, and we've had years to do it. All we've done is drain our rainy day fund right to the brink of where the people that set our bond ratings are lowering our ratings, and they're threatening to do even worse. And we've gotten to the point where all the low-hanging waste is gone. So then when you really look at it and you're me, you gotta come up with a solution. I hate like crazy to raise taxes in any way, shape, form, or fashion, but we've got to have a pathway out. And today, what we need to do is we need to find a pathway that will take us to prosperity. And the other thing we'll be able to do as we move down that pathway, we'll be able to double back and any kind of modest raise in any level of taxes, we'll be able to take them back away.
I want to chime in here for a second. You brought up the tax thing here. Well, I got a question here from Lisa Schaefer. She's a records management worker in Big Chimney. It's a state agency.
Right.
She says she's had no raise in 10 years. She told us how much she makes. I'm not going to divulge that information. That's her own private business. But she says she barely gets by to pay her bills, pay for food, meds for her and her son. She's not eligible for a lot of subsidies because she's above that magic number where you get a lot of help from the government. And it's in that pocket that a lot of West Virginians are really suffering. They're digging, scraping by as best they can. She wants to know what you'll be doing for those families. And hold your thought for a second, because it kind of ties in with this next question from Caroline Balzer, or Bowser. I'm sorry if I mispronounced your last name. She's from Houston. She says, I understand you're trying to create revenue, but isn't there another way besides raising an already high gas tax? I believe we're 18th in the country right now. Under your proposal, we would go to 5th highest gas tax. Where I'm getting at here is it can be argued by a lot of people that the taxes that you're proposing specifically, in many ways, a lot of them are regressive, meaning that they will hurt the lower income families disproportionately more than others. Is there another avenue that you can go down to raise revenue without taxing lower income families like that?
Well, Rick, let me explain this whole thing. Today, or yesterday, the Republicans came out and said, basically, we've got to live within our means. And I'll just hold that thought. Think about this lady that you're talking about. She's just barely making. Think about a household that a mom and a dad had a job, and the mom lost the job. And the dad had a job maybe as a miner or whatever that was making 90 grand a year. Now he's driving a snow plow for the state and he's making 30,000. And we say, look, they're already feeding their kids beanie weenies and trying to get by. And they're doing everything they can do. And they've been really patient. They've sat there for 3 years waiting on us to help them and come up with a solution. And we haven't, have we? And it's just getting worse. And every day, every single day that goes by, we're 50th, we're 50th, we're 50th. And now we go to those people and say, you've got to even do better, because we've got to have even more cuts. Now we want you to just feed your kids once a day and feed them cornbread. You really think more people are going to come to West Virginia with that kind of attitude? We've got to think differently. We've proven how to be dead last. Now listen to me on my tax increases. And somebody, pray tell, tell me how bad this is going to hurt us. I totally believe that we need to all pull the rope together. And by all, I mean the wealthiest people. And I'm saying the wealthiest people need to pay a $500, a $750, or a $1,000, depending on if you're making $200 grand, $250, or $300,000. Won't hurt the wealthy people at all. I'm saying the average everyday guy needs to pay a quarter of a penny more on sales tax. That's it. And underneath that, the businesses, because we all need to be in this together, need to pay three quarters of a tenth, which is next to nothing. Now I went over and I laid it a little heavier on cigarettes and soft drinks because we need to get as much rid of that as we possibly can for the health and well-being of our people. That's it. That's it. And if we do that, we don't have to close West Liberty. We don't have to do away with Promise Scholarship. Do you realize what is right on the threshold of happening to us? And every time we constrict a little bit more, you know what happens? More people leave. And when more people leave, the revenue goes down. And when the revenue goes down, the hole's still right here behind you. And you never get out of it. Now, nobody wants to do that. And as far as the gas side, that's the left side of the equation. The right-hand side of the equation is just as simple as mud. 4.5 cents on gas tax. 4.5 cents. Raise the tolls, and if you go on a toll road, mountaineers should go for free. We'll charge you $8 for an easy pass if you want it. If you don't ever go on a toll road, you don't get it. If you're from out of state and you want to go on our toll roads, $8. Mountaineers will always go for free. Now, that's it. That's the bottom line of the whole deal. And you know what that'll get us? 48,000 new jobs.
Also a DMV increase though, right?
DMV increase, I'm sorry. DMV increase from $30 to $50, I'm sorry. You're exactly right.
And that's $20, that's, you know.
That's $20, but the other thing we do is we eliminate the inspection of your vehicles to once every 3 years. So it's almost a wash. It's not quite a wash, maybe, but almost a wash. Now think about what that's going to do for you. New highways, excess money to fix the potholes and fix the existing roads, 48,000 new jobs. It'll take West Virginia off like a blooming rocket ship. Do you know what the payroll tax are on 48,000 new jobs? That's as many people as there is in Charleston. The payroll tax are $250 million. Now look, if I am telling you, if you like where we're at and you want to get just a little bit sicker or your heart rate wants to slow a little bit more, then you didn't need me. You didn't need me because you're going to die. That's all there is to it. The patient is going to die. Now if you're willing, for those increases to close West Liberty, take away Promise Scholarship, close our state parks, if you're willing to do that, I'm not, because I think we're better than that.
Let's start getting to some of the questions from our audience here. Kenny Bass is standing by with a question.
Hi, introduce yourself, tell us where you're from. Tell us where you're from, we're gonna get the microphone to you, then ask the governor your question.
I'm Cliff Wilson from Wheeling, and I used to be a school principal in this county. And I want to thank you, Governor, for all your hard work. I'll tell you, it's a tough grind. I want to contribute to your SOS program. And I want to give you a check tonight. No, I don't have a check tonight, but I'll send you a check, sir.
What's your question?
My question is, how is that SOS program going?
Well, it's go ahead, Kenny, I'm sorry. I mean, the question is about the SOS program. You see, I think we got to market our state too. And originally I put in my budget $105 million to market our state, to develop commercial sites, to entice business to come. to go out and do what all the other states are doing. And I said, no, let's do this. Let's cut that into a third. Let's only do 35 million now because things are tough. But we've got, let's quit. For crying out loud, I keep going back to the same thing. We're too blooming good. We're West Virginians. You don't need to turn on your television every night and see come to Michigan. For crying out loud, do we want to really get on a bus and go to Detroit? Are you kidding me? We wonder why tourism struggles in West Virginia. Do we market our state? Do we have commercial sites that really, if people want to come? My roads program, think about this just for a second. You've got a severe drug problem here, do you not? We've got it all over our state. Do you know in my roads program, think about the other things besides the 48,000 jobs. Think about just this. There's a component that says we'll bid all the jobs labor intensive. That means we're going to basically be a field for retrain or apprenticeship right on the job. And in addition to that, we're going to charge a 5% buyer's fee or construction fee for the winning bidders on $2.4 billion of road work that's ready to go right now. This is right now, okay? Now, if you got that 5% money, 5% of $2.4 million is $120 million. We're going to put it in a bucket, and we're going to fix this drug problem. We're going to fix it. That's all there is to it. We're going to put more social workers out there. We're going to put more police out there. We're going to build treatment facilities. We're going to bring our people back, and we're going to fix this bad problem.
All right. With that, we have to take a quick break, but we'll come right back after this with much more of Your Voice, Your Future, a town hall meeting discussing the budget crisis with Governor Jim Justice.
That's where Mickelson went to school. Yeah.
He was there when I was in high school. He was playing.
Oh, really? Oh, okay.
And we would go watch him play. And he was playing like a regular tournament against like Stanford or something. And he was the first front nine to mess around. He'd be like 5 6 shots back. And then back nine, birdie.
Oh, shoot.
He could just turn it on whenever he wanted.
He's a good guy. This lady was the most outstanding in Marshall County.
Back inside the Troy Theater, we went to break talking about roads. So I just wanted to ask you, because we've had numerous questions from people wondering, with the state that we're in right now, $500 million budget deficit, is spending $100 million on a 3-mile access road into the Hobet site feasible right now? Is that something that you're still 100% behind?
I don't know. It's a very good question, and to be perfectly honest, it may be something that we got to lay aside, for a period of time. I think it's still a very viable project, don't get me wrong, and we're very, very hopeful, but it is a big time bet on the come. It really is, and there's no question that it is a big spend, and the real estate then becomes very, very expensive. And so there's a lot of discussion. I'm not committed 100%, and it may very well be something that we say we are committed to do, but we just can't do it right now.
Greenbrier owner, they have a casino. For those that might have missed the craps reference, a bet on the come means down the road.
Yeah, you're
hoping
that's right.
That'll pay off later.
Well, that's right. We may have to, yeah, that's right.
Let's go over to Rich again with more questions from social media.
Rick, thanks. I want to jump back over to taxes specifically on gas and cigarettes you were talking about just a couple of minutes ago. And in the Northern Panhandle specifically, West Virginia is bordered by two states very closely. So the question comes from Todd Schmidt. How will you increase revenue by increasing taxes on gas and cigs on border retailers when Ohio is already cheaper?
Well, it's a good question. But at the same time, we've taken into consideration the impacts of the fact that the people may very well go across the border and buy something and everything. But the same thing happens if you significantly increase sales tax. I mean, you know, there's even a thought that going around that, well, let's get rid of the state income tax. I would love it. I think it would be a great, lofty goal, and we need to do that. But we don't need to do that while the patient is laying in the intensive care unit and jump it all the way to the Olympics. We can't do that because we're going to lay right at the doorstep. All the burden is going to be on the average everyday working guy. So we have taken into consideration there may very well be some people that go across the border and everything to buy gas or buy cigarettes or whatever. But we've taken all that into our numbers.
Cigarettes, though.
I'm sorry?
What would it do to the businesses that are selling that gas and cigarettes?
The local mom and pop convenience stores.
You know, I really don't think that people are going to be negatively impacted to the tune of what that anyone could perceive. I mean, 4.5 cents is not going to drive people. I mean, you can't drive around the block and back on the 4.5 cent savings. And so I don't think that's going to be the end-all, do-all at all.
Kenny Bass has another question from our audience tonight.
Hi. Introduce yourself, say where you're from, and what do you have for the governor?
Hi, Governor. My name is Josh Gary. I'm a teacher at John Marshall High School, about 12 miles south of here.
Right.
I want to say I think you're doing a great job, and I want to thank you for doing a lot for us and trying to do a lot for us. But my question really is, I've been teaching for over 15 years. A lot of us teachers make less than the states around us. We're always asked to give more of our time, but we're asked to take less in benefits, and then again, we're told no to a pay raise, although I know you have recommended that we get one, and I appreciate that. But PEIA is still not funded. There's been really no answer of how to fix it.
What's your question?
Okay, I'm getting it to it, I promise. they're saying we want to cut $150 million out of education and strip our rights to job security and seniority in House Bills 2569. And 2738. What's your plan to stop making West Virginia education a political punching bag and actually making it a priority?
And in context, the legislative proposal would take away that 2% teacher pay raise that you have proposed.
Right. Okay, again, let me just level with you. In education, we've proven how to be dead last, have we not? We've layered in bureaucracy upon bureaucracy upon bureaucracy. In 1980, we had half as many students as we had two times as many students as we have today, and today we've got 10 times as many bureaucrats telling this man what to do. We don't listen to this man at all. We don't listen to our teachers, and we need to reform education all the way across the board. I am absolutely all at doing that. Education needs to be the centerpiece of what we do. If it were working, I'd be standing there applauding. But it's not working. We have 1,150 Charleston bureaucrats that are telling our teachers what to do, and our teachers need to go teach. They want to teach, and they need to be rewarded and feel appreciated too. I mean, they've been beat down, and my 2%, I apologized in the state of the state because it could only be 2%. And now, the first thing that happens is the other side says, no, we're taking it away from you. You don't need that and everything. It's wrong.
Is that going to be your line in the sand? The Republicans have said that they can find reasonable cuts in the big three, higher education, public education, K-12, and the DHHR. Are you adamantly against cutting into any of those?
Listen, in DHHR, I mean, you're talking about the weakest and the poorest and the most needy and the disabled. Why don't the Republicans, this is almost like saying, where's the beef? I mean, where's the beef? Why don't they tell us what senior facility that they're willing to shut down? What school are they willing to shut down? What group of disabled people are they willing to walk away from? I mean, I am telling you as sincerely as I can tell you, I don't want a thing for Jim. That's one thing you can put in the bank. I've become your governor for you. Now, at the end of the rainbow, we can talk about, well, we need more out of DHHR, or we need more out of higher ed. Well, that's where we go all the time. We just take more out of higher ed. Well, for crying out loud, you know, why don't we man up and say what we really want to do? Are you going to close Concord State? Are you going to close West Liberty? Are you going to close Fairmont State? Are you going to close this park or that park? What are you going to do? You know,
they gave
you congratulate you. They gave me a framework.
By the way, if that guy's been teaching for 15 years, we need to eat more of what he's eating. He looks like a student.
Well, that's right. That's exactly right. And I thank you for your service.
They came up with a framework.
That's right.
They said they had some cuts. Today in Senate Finance, they said that eliminating the subsidies for Greyhound racing would save $15 million annually. They're coming up with little things here and there. But again, nothing that the number that they're wanting to get to, you'd have to cut into the big three somehow. So again, is that your hard line? There's no cuts with you as governor. You'll veto anything that cuts into education or DHHR?
Okay, I've got to do this in Jim's words, okay?
But I don't want James to come out. Let's stay at Jim.
Okay, just listen to me. If they do things that are going to cripple our state and slow the heart rate on the patient from 20 to 5 where we can never get out of the bed, I'm vetoing it. That's the end of that. The other thing is just this, and this happened, you know, I do a lot of things with examples or analogies, but at Greenbrier East High School one day, there was a kid that on the way to school that somebody had run over a raccoon, and he picked it up dead and threw it in his truck and came to school and took some fishing line and put it around his neck and tied it around his leg and went running down the hall screaming bloody murder like the raccoon was right after him, and people were diving everywhere. And he ended up getting suspended. I thought the kid was pretty daggum original, to tell you the truth. But I am telling you, the proposal of framework does not have specifics. It uses one-time money, and the net-net of the whole thing is when you look over your shoulder, that is still right there. And next year, it's going to be the same thing. We ran the numbers, $394 million, $497 million this year, $394 million next year. It's right there. It's not going anywhere, and part of the people are going to leave. And then what are we going to do?
Kenny Bass has another question.
I feel way underdressed, and I got a tie on. I mean, congratulations, first of all, on your title. Who are you? Where are you from? You can tell us what you want and your question for the governor.
Thank you. Hi again. My name is Grace Myers. I'm Miss Marshall County's Outstanding Teen 2017. I'm part of the Miss West Virginia and the Miss America organization, and I'm here today to represent my generation. So my platform revolves around defeating childhood obesity. 1 in 3 children are obese or overweight, and with our state being one of the most obese states in the country, if this trend continues, my generation will not outlive your generation. So my question is to you. Is it possible to distribute some of the money generated from the imposed sugar tax to go towards defeating childhood obesity, like improving and becoming safer playgrounds and improving physical education?
Absolutely. You know, and I don't see how anyone that's as beautiful as you and as outstanding as you could bring up an obesity question to me. I mean, come on. Jimmy, Christmas. You know, I mean, that's a low blow right off the get-go. But it is serious. You know, Dr. Clay Marsh, and I wish I had my phone, but Dr. Clay Marsh said, it just came out not long ago, like a well-being index, and Gallup rated us in West Virginia dead last. And part of the health of well-being centers around community and love and safety. And if you don't have that well-being, it's not all just that you eat right and you do jumping jacks. You've got it. It centers around who we are and how we feel about ourselves and how others on the outside feel about us. And if you don't have that well-being, you're just lined up for cancer, heart disease, diabetes, and a lot of the great or the terrible things that you're talking about. And so we need to address that. And Dr. Clay Marsh and I are on the same page with one another, and he's the head doc over at WVU. Wonderful man, and you know, under the leadership of Gordon Gee, it's good stuff. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Rich, you have another question from social?
I do, yes. This is a topic that we've had several people tweet us about, email us about, and post on Facebook. So I'll ask one version of it. This from Kayla in Glendale. As a wife of a current employee of the state of West Virginia with two young children, I'm very concerned with our budget issues. Although we realize that the monetary benefit could take years, have you thought about taking steps to legalize and tax medical or recreational marijuana in order to help regulate the budget?
The elephant in the room. A lot of states are making a bucket load of money doing that.
Well, here's how I feel. As far as medical marijuana, I can't turn my back on that. And the reason I can't turn my back on that is all of us have got loved ones, and if the docs say that that can help, we surely don't want to turn our back and we want to try to help. So I'm all in there. As far as legalizing marijuana in our state, I am not there at all. And the reason I'm not there is real simple. We have a terrible, terrible drug problem today. Layering in another component of that until we get our feet under us and get this drug problem under control, just because we're destitute and we need the money. It's similar to me to say, well, I'll tell you what let's do. Let's have 25 nuclear waste sites in West Virginia because we need the money. We know we've got a terrible drug problem. We can't layer on something else today. Not today.
Down the road, possibly, though. Of course, the counter to that is if you get in early, there's probably more money to be made. It seems as though that's the way that the ball is rolling. It's trending. State after state after state keeps legalizing it.
Well, first, like I said, it's just like everything. I mean, you can't run before you walk. You can't walk before you crawl. Let's see what happens down the road.
All right, we have to take another quick break, but when we come back, more questions from the audience as our town hall continues. Your voice, your future, the budget crisis 2017 with Governor Justice. Voice your future. As we get our microphone situation settled, I already had a faux pas with my mic dropping, and you're quicker than I am. You got that in there pretty quickly. Let's send it right back over to Kenny Bass. He's got another question from our audience.
A couple of quick things. One, you think you feel bad about the obesity questions? I look like the guy that ate Kenny Bass. On the medical marijuana, a little bit more seriously, there was a procedural move in the House just last week on an amendment stage on a bill where it was talked about, it wouldn't have legalized medical marijuana, but it would have changed marijuana from a Schedule 1 to a Schedule 4. That was defeated, 64-35. So it's not just the governor. There is no will in the legislature right now for medical or recreational marijuana.
Not surprisingly, given it's a very conservative state house.
At the current makeup of the state house right now, it's not a possibility. We have a question. Young man, introduce yourself, say hi to the governor, and ask your question.
Hi, Governor. I'm Alec Kusky from Moundsville, just north of here, and I'm a junior in John Marshall High School. My question is, with the State Board of Education's recent decision to move away from smarter balanced standardized testing, are you willing to replace standardized testing with the ACT and SAT standards? While it may not directly correlate to our state budget, it will benefit the educational standards.
And that's something you wanted to do. You wanted to get away from smarter balanced, and you wanted to get away from the
absolutely.
A through F.
We need to get away from just testing our kids teetotally to death. We need to use the ACT system. We can use ACT Aspire for grades 3 through 8. We can use the ACT test in the 11th grade. Absolutely, we need to get away from it. It save us a pile of money. It may save us close to half the money that we're going to, you know, need to raise our teacher salaries. But absolutely, we need to do that.
Apparently, your good buddy, Majority Leader Ryan Ferns, is weighing in tonight on Twitter.
That's good.
So let's send it over to Rich. He's been monitoring what's going on.
Governor Justice, this is not the first question we've had about this. So I'm just going to ask Senator Ferns' version of this question. When will you pay the millions in past due taxes your companies owe to the state? That's Senator Ferns' question.
Well, I'm glad he asked, because you should know. You know, from time to time, there's disputes. I mean, I probably pay annually about $70 million in taxes. And one thing that you can rest assured, every single dime, every single obligation I have ever had, I pay. Everything. You don't need to worry about that. We need to take that completely off the table. In fact, there's money's even escrowed right now, and we're working through a process right now. When we get through the process, they'll be paid instantly. But nevertheless, you know, it's just complicated. There's a lot to it. And the last thing that I think, you know, that Senator Fern needs to do is be occupied with that. I mean, he has made a living out of tweet, sarcasm, this and that and everything else. And you saw what my response to all that was. So
grizzly bears and poodles.
Well, I mean, here's the thing, you know, keep in mind now, and I can give you the list. Over and over and over, all kinds of tweets and everything and sarcasm and just stuff that's not productive. And when I was asked by Hoppy Kirchhoff, he said, does that bother you? Well, it doesn't really bother you, but it just came to my mind, and I just kept thinking, well, here I go, you know, walking through the woods and everything, and I can just feel this behind me, just nip, 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 for nothing. And I just thought, well, isn't this just perfect for Ryan Fern to be the poodle? And then right behind it, if I were the poodle, I'd be concerned that the grizz may just turn around and it may not be good.
He does represent this area. He's a senator.
I know he represents y'all.
And
you know, and I think you should take all this into account. I mean, you know, here we are sitting here trying to do something productive, and he calls up and says, hey, Justice, when are you going to pay your taxes? Well, what good is that?
And it is Ryan Ferns, by the way.
Okay,
I don't know if
Ferns.
You're purposely keeping
no,
off.
No, I didn't mean, I surely didn't mean that.
But again, it goes back to the whole throwing barbs back and forth. You're a smart guy. I mean, you don't get to be where you are without being a smart guy. You come off as very folksy, you're down to earth, you're one of us. And that's one of the reasons you got elected, because you connect with people, they buy in. But behind all of that, you're a very smart man. So you have to be self-aware enough, I'm sure, to know that when you say, my way is the only way, and then you have the Republican legislature saying, no, our way is the only way, when everyone is speaking in absolutes, the people that elected you all, we're not that stupid. We know that the real solution, the best solution, is probably somewhere in the middle. Now, how far you want to go, it's middle-ish, so to speak. I'm not out here asking you, can you compromise? Because we know there is a compromise there. My question to you is, as the leader of the state, what can you do to get everyone into one room, to check their egos, and to get this done?
Okay, let's kind of go back. Let's, you know, first of all, I am folksy, and I like people, and I love being here with you. But I can either be Jimmy, like I am, or I can be Jim, or I can be James. And I'm gonna tell you, at times, you don't get where I get to in life by just being Jimmy all the time. And I can tell you just this, is for the other side to say, well, We don't like that. You know, I would say, grow up, you bunch of baby snowflakes. I mean, for God's sakes, a living, let's get it done. Let's bloom and get it done, you know? I mean, I would be the first to say, tomorrow, let's get in a room and let's dedicate 5 hours a day. 5 hours a day, every day until we pass a budget. And let's work through every little single point and let's get there. Let's quit being babies. I mean, for crying out loud, this is serious stuff. And it really impacts everybody's lives in this state. I'm wanting to get something done and get it done in a productive way. Absolutely, I'll listen to any and every idea, and I hope they'll listen to mine.
If they come to you with $4.2 billion, that's what you spent last year, is that something you'd be willing to work with?
I don't know. I I'm not dodging the question, but just to say, now, let's be fair. Let's say that they come to me and they say, let's kill these people over here, and you can have these people over here that can live. Why do we need to do that if it's the wrong thing to do? Well, because it's going to hurt those people. It's going to really hurt them if we kill them.
There would be some that say that no matter what happens, there's going to have to be tough decisions made.
There's no question there's going to be tough decisions, but if there's pathways out of this where the pain is smaller and the future is brighter, then we don't need to do something that's just stupid so people can have scalps. We don't need to do that just because people would say never. We need to do the smart thing. I've said it many times. You want to be in Alaska? I want to be in the desert? It doesn't mean we just land in Iowa and say, well, Iowa's the place to be.
Iowa's not that bad.
Iowa's not that bad. But if Iowa's the wrong place to be, we just don't need to be there because that's halfway.
Kenny Bass.
They made knucklehead hats in the Senate after you called them knuckleheads. I'll look for baby snowflakes this week. I'll see if they come up with any.
I shouldn't have done that. I know. I should have done that. You got me all whipped up. I mean, I shouldn't have done that.
The legislators this week, by the way, told us in the media when they presented their budget, they don't have the power to tell DHHR and higher ed and K-12 what to cut. They're just going to give them a number and say, now it's up to you to decide what to cut. Let's let her ask a question and you can dive into that. Hello. And you're up next.
My name is Mary Ellen Cassidy. I'm from Wheeling, West Virginia. I have a question about diversifying and growing our workforce. My husband and I have a small business here, and we upgraded, did an energy audit, upgraded our building. We have solar panels on the building. I know that you're big on energy efficiency. My question is, are you thinking of any policies or incentives or initiatives that will help particularly low-income families, small businesses, be able to afford the upfront costs so they can recoup their savings on utilities, like integrated resource planning with the utilities, local energy efficiency partnerships, or possibly something to do with our income, low-income housing to help them because they're really hit by utility bills?
Incentives to kickstart small business.
I think it's a great question, and let me even go even further in depth. I mean, the question centers around incentivizing people to do alternative energy things or to do things that are energy savings. You know, it's a great idea and everything, and I can go one step further and just say just this. Think about this. You're a regulated electricity state, and we may 140% of the electricity that we use within the state, 40% of it's going out of here. We need to figure out a way to make that workforce. Now, I haven't quite figured that out yet, you know, how we could basically charge more for the electricity that left us and lesser or incentivize and do exactly what you're saying for those of us that are here. But along the same lines, natural gas just fell out of the sky on us, and it's a blessing beyond belief. And today, we're struggling with natural gas from the standpoint of marketing, and they need you know, advantages with their leasing, and they need marketing. You know, I would just say this. Some way, somehow, we have got to create an energy loop between Ohio and Pennsylvania and ourselves right here to where we would actually attract multiple crackers and have the ability to have the use of that gas and manufacturing fall right in our lap right here.
That's something that Senator Manchin has mentioned as well, an energy hub
for this region.
Is that something that you've been in communications with him about?
Absolutely, absolutely. And it's real. It's absolutely real. I mean, they always put the hog confinement building by the cornfield. Well, they need to put the cracker by the cheapest gas. You know, but in addition to that, think about this just for a second. I am all for tiering the severance tax on gas and tiering the severance tax on coal, and I haven't had hardly any pushback from the gas people or the coal people on that. But in addition to that, think about this. If we were to build pipelines, and those pipelines would leave West Virginia, we don't want to be standing there like a third world country and everything, and the value added is gone. So what I would propose is just this. When we go out of the state of West Virginia, when it leaves our borders, we have to have another additional tax layer of wheelage. And basically what that is when you go across our lands and then you leave, you pay us. And so the net of the whole thing, it's a complicated answer and everything, but you know, there are so many things that we need to be doing to incentivize businesses and to incentivize ourselves to do prudent and right things. But really and true, that's almost next step. You've got to make sure the patient's going to live first.
Rich, with another question from social media.
We do have a question here. This has to do with Greyhound subsidies. Governor Justice, I think that eliminating the Greyhound subsidies and eliminating the casino modernization subsidies will only cause more loss of jobs and also result in less revenue coming into the state through both income taxes and also gambling revenue. Is this a good idea when the state is already in the budget crisis it's in? I don't think so. What do you think? And that's from Heather Anderson.
Okay, here's what I think. Think what the Republicans proposed. Take out the money that won't continue on. And then let's just go down the list. We're going to save $9 million and cut out our dogs. And we're going to save another $9 million maybe on, or five or six or whatever million dollars on the casino modernization stuff where they update their slot machines or whatever. Well, we're going to save a little bit here, a little bit there, and a little bit here and everything else, which is real money. Don't get me wrong. It's real money. But at the end of the rainbow, you got a $500 million problem here, guys. And when you add up the real money, you come to $48, $46 million. I mean, I was all for the smoothing on the teacher's retirement. I'm the one that came up with that. I'm the one that came up and said, let's not charge our vets, you know, state income tax on their retirement, and that will attract many, many, many more retired vets here. I'm the one that came up with the thing on the education stuff. I'm not leading you in the wrong path, but what I'm telling you is, if you take our dogs away from us, there's people. The $64 question is always this. Whatever we cut, ask one question. Are more people going to come, or are more people going to leave? And if more people leave, revenue goes down. That's all you got to ask, and it'll lead you to the right answers. Now, I'm not going to choose our dogs over our people. And if it gets to being the dogs to get this done or our people, well, I'm going to choose our people because that's just smart. But I'm telling you, everything that we take away takes away a part of our well-being.
Would you be willing to concede that maybe that was a bit of an olive branch from the GOP saying, okay, look, here's an easy cut, and I'm using that their words, not necessarily easy for everyone involved, because as you said, there's always people behind the scenes, but they said today in Senate Finance that $15 million annually could be saved by getting rid of the Greyhound subsidies. Those would be left to their own. If they want to continue trying to race, they're on their own dime. The bottom line is people aren't going to the track for Greyhound and dog and horse racing as much as they used to be. It's a dying industry. $9 million for the Casino Modernization Fund. Yes, that's only $24 million. You start adding those up, though, and you can get to a number where then maybe they can say, okay, now maybe we'll work with you on your tax increases. We'll come down a little off that. And then you're to the middle enough where you're talking about a real possibility to get this done. Do you view it as maybe them saying, okay, let's start to get to work, or
sure,
do you just think that
sure, that's what we're gonna do. I mean, ultimately, at the end of the rainbow, that's what you gotta do. And but what I am saying to you, I keep going back to the same thing. Philosophically, you've got to remember just one thing, and that is, if you cut us into the bone, we won't recover. And that's where I draw the line. You know, that's where the line in the sand is. You know, we're going to have additional revenues. We're going to have them, you know. But can we cut out some additional waste or cut out some things maybe that we'd like to have, but we just can't afford to have? Sure.
All right, we'll take another quick break, and we'll be right back with more Town Hall Meeting, Your Voice, Your Future, talking about the budget crisis with the governor. Back live inside Swin Hall at the Troy Theater. Let's get right to some questions from Kenny. We got about 15 minutes left, Kenny, so let's get through as many of these as we can.
Joel Van Allen, what question do you have for the governor?
Nick Zervis, Executive Director of RESA 6 in Wheeling.
What's your question?
First of all, I want to thank the governor for being here. I do want to tell you that I'm one of those bureaucrats that you've talked about. I've been in education for 44 years, and I've helped a lot of children, just like you have in basketball.
Your question, sir.
The more importantly, we have built teachers and students. My question to you is, in phasing out the zero in your budget for RESAs, our return on the budget is $12 for every $1 that's given to us by the legislature. And so, two things. Number one, this same crisis existed 30 years ago, and they handled it in 1 year when Gaston Caperton was here.
Question.
They balanced the budget. The question is, if we give $12 for every $1 that you expend on RESAs, our model ought to be used across the state and all government agencies to give back. What would you do in order to maintain that kind of return on investment that RESAs give?
Excellent. Thank you.
Well, let me say this. I am no education expert. I have my teaching degree, and I'm very proud of that, and I'm a coach. And I know we've got issues, and you'll agree we have issues. And there's no question that the RESAs have done great work in many, many different areas, and I congratulate you and I thank you, and I really do. And you're speaking of a 12-to-1 return on dollars there. And now you're out of my bailiwick and you're out of my field. I can tell you it would be foolish is what it would be for us to turn our back on a 12-to-1 return, no matter what it would be. But at the same time, we do have real issues within education, and we need to restore as much as we possibly can back into the local hands to be able to let the local people that are on the ground know what to do.
Let's get to the next question. I just want to mention, out of respect for everyone that's still waiting in line, let's try to be as concise as possible with these questions.
Hi, introduce yourself and ask your question.
My name is Patricia Jacobson. I'm from Wheeling. I've lived here since 1967. Your budget, as I understand it, your budget cuts all funding for public broadcasting, which serves all West Virginians, and it keeps us informed of
your question, real quick.
Of all areas of the state, from Bluefields to Weirton, from Huntington to Berkeley Springs, and it keeps us also informed of the proceedings in the legislature. I'm just asking you not to cut public broadcasting.
Well, let me, I don't mean to interrupt, but let me jump right in because I'm trying to get all these questions. Let me say this about public broadcasting. I think we have something worked out or in the process, and I hope I'm not scooping somebody, to where WVU is going to really step in and really help us keep our public broadcasting. Look, guys, at the end of the day, the budget cuts that I offered up are minuscule in comparison to the problem. And with everything that was offered up, I'm just offering up the beginning part of a bargaining process. I don't want to get rid of public broadcasting.
Introduce yourself, ask your question.
Owens Brown.
Hey, Owen.
How you doing, Governor? Question, the battle of Obamacare is raging across the country. If Obamacare is repealed, what impact will it have on the state of West Virginia? Medicare expansion brings in $700 million. What will that do to your budget? And what will it do to the 144,000 people that depends on Medicaid?
Thank you.
To be perfectly honest, sir, I don't know. And it's a good question. And we've got a lot of people out there that, again, are the poorest and the weakest and maybe the sickest and the most disabled. I think it's premature because we don't really know what the program's going to be like if Obamacare leaves. But we've got to also remember just this, and that is Obamacare, the way it was becoming a nightmare. And we've got to really remember that. Now, we can't walk away from our people. And I hope and pray that whatever comes out of it, we don't end up doing that. Now, I've got to say one other thing tonight, and I've got to say just this, and I want everybody to listen to me on this. You've got a minority bunch of Democrats that are down there and they're working. I would say to the Republicans and the Democrats both, first and foremost, let's lay aside whether you're a Democrat or a Republican, and first and foremost be West Virginians. But I can tell you this, it takes a lot of guts from the Democrat side to say, we're willing to stand for a tax increase, especially when you're in a really red state. That takes a lot of guts to say, really, what I'm wanting to do is be a West Virginian first and a Democrat second. Now, a lot of you were Democrats forevermore, and then Obama made you really cold. Now, I can tell you that there's a lot of good Democrats that are trying for you. And I could have been a Republican or a Democrat, either one. I'm not speaking as a Democrat or a Republican. I'm just telling you fact.
That sounds like something Larry Puccio made you say.
Oh, gosh, no. Please.
Got about 4 minutes left. Please. Introduce yourself. Ask your question.
Good evening, Governor. My name is Alan Hall. I'm from Moundsville, West Virginia. I work for the West Virginia Department of Highways. My question is, with the competitiveness of wages outside of the state for state workers, such as bridge inspectors as myself, what are you going to do to bring more jobs to the Department of Highways so that we can maintain our roads and our structures?
And more money for workers.
And more money for workers.
Well, here, you know, we've got a wonderful leader of the band in Tom Smith, in Transportation Secretary. Just stay with me on this. I said to Tom Smith, I said, Tom, if you look at your engineers and you have 100, let's hope and pray that you'll hire 1,000 more. Because that's what we want to do. We want to be building highways all over the place and have jobs and jobs and a network of roads that people aren't scared to death to come here. And then once they're here, they're not worried to death how they're going to get out of here. You know, so we're on that.
You got another question? Sure. Introduce yourself and ask your question.
Hi, I'm Aaron Moles. I work with the operators in the building trades in West Virginia. One question I have, we see a lot of out-of-staters and stuff working here, which is fine, but we have an issue. I think would you look into a bill possibly or into something in the budget that we would require these out-of-state contractors to hire 85% local people and then impose a severance tax higher if they don't? And with that severance tax, the money could go back into the system wherever we need it.
But West Virginia's to work.
I think it's legitimate for me to be said of me that I want West Virginians to be first. But you know what I want? I want there to be so many jobs that we don't have enough West Virginians to even halfway fill the jobs. And just more and more and more people are going to want to come to our great state and end up living in our great state.
Got one more. Okay. Got about 2 minutes, so
two
be quick.
Left.
We'll say hey and ask you a question.
Okay. My name is Rob Schmidt. I'm a local businessman in Wheeling. I'm going to be negatively impacted by every single one of your tax proposals, so you can't just say, oh, it's just going to be washed off.
What's your question?
My question is this. I feel as though you're just going to be putting a finger in the dike, and you're not going to generate the real money, okay, that's going to be necessary to make the changes that this state needs to progress, okay? My question is, why can't we go and get more severance tax from these people that are going to be making hundreds of billions of dollars over the next several years, and we're not going to be getting the return, but yet...
Got to give him time to answer. We're running out of time.
Go ahead.
Go ahead. Got about a minute and a half.
Raising the severance tax, as and I'm sure we're speaking primarily of gas, but, you know, because coal has struggled and everything, but raising the severance tax and tearing the severance tax up as gas prices move up, I'm 100% for that. I hear you in that you may think that these taxes that do impact you in a negative way, you know, are not going to be the end-all do-all. But the 48,000 jobs is the end-all do-all because it generates an unbelievable amount of money. And I hate the fact that a quarter of a penny or four and a half cents or whatever negatively impacts. But now just think about this. You know, the Greenbrier Hotel, $125 million a year business, the business tax on the Greenbrier Hotel is $93,000. Well, I'll promise you the Greenbrier Hotel ought to be able to afford that with $125 million of gross income.
15 seconds, go.
If you're a gun shop and you've got a gross income of $5,000 a month, your tax yearly is $45. That's what we're looking at.
All right. Well, we got through everything without you even having to go to the whiteboard. How about that?
Well, I was just too tired to get up. I mean, that's all.
For Kenny Bass, Rich Pierce, I'm Rick Lord. Thanks for joining us on this Town Hall, Your Voice, Your Future.
Thank you, sir.